Welcome to the Custer Community Church. My name is Rob Rice. Our organist today is Roberta Fischesser from the Our Redeemer Lutheran Church. Lois Wells will be at the piano for these duets. With introductions, we will move immediately into each of four pieces. And the first piece is To God Be the Glory, written by the blind songwriter named Fanny Crosby, who was born in 1820. She became blind at the age of 2 months. She was able to memorize most of the Bible and wrote over 1,000 poems, many that became the loved hymns, used as a final hymn for many of Billy Graham's crusades. To God Be the Glory begins with the words, To God be the glory, great things he hath done, so loved he the world that God gave us his Son.
Thank you.
God, our help in ages past, was written by Isaac Watts in 1719, that's 301 years ago. The words were inspired by Psalms 90. It begins with, O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, our eternal home.
Thank you.
final piece is called A Symphony of Spirituals with well-known African-American spirituals, including Go Down Moses, I Want Jesus to Walk with Me, Let Us Break Bread Together, Great Day, Swing Low Sweet Chariot, and Promised Land, all arranged by Joel Rainey in 2001, who also arranged our last piece in 2012.
Thank you. church. We're glad you're here. Just a few announcements and reminders. If you don't know me, and I know most of you here that are present know me, but probably some that might be watching this later on today may not know me. So my name is Barb Paulson, and I am the chairman of the church council here at Custer Community Church at this time. Just a reminder that next Sunday we will have our church budget meeting following the service. That is Sunday, November 22nd. A Zoom link will be made available for those who wish to participate via Zoom, and you can contact the office to get the link emailed to you. Also, we have our Angel Tree donations. There's a tree out in the lobby, and we need those donations in by December 1st. And this time it is just a monetary donation. They will be purchasing the gifts. I know that takes out a little fun in the whole process, but due to the circumstances we're in right now, that is how we need to do it. So thank you for being part of that. And I guess our opening hymn today is going to be, I'm going to sing hymn number 73, Enter, Rejoice, and Come In. And we did not practice this ahead of time. So. Mistakes and to help you through any troubles that are still with you. to ask God for mercy, feel these burdens being lifted from you. Look forward to the week ahead. Finally, think about the week ahead. What is exciting for you? What are you nervous about? Ask God to be with you in the week to come. Trust. Know that whatever comes in the immediate future and in the long-term future, God will go with you. Amen.
Jesus knows that he will believe
be leaving his disciples soon, and so he tells them a parable of a master who is leaving. When the master leaves, he calls three of his servants and gives each one of them talents. One gets five, one gets two, and one gets one talent, which they're supposed to invest for the master while he's away. The word talent has two meanings. The original meaning of the word talent in Greek language is a measure of money, a huge amount of money. The average pay for one day's work was a denarius. One talent is 5,300 denarius, or 5,300 days' wages. This is equivalent to the amount of money you'd earn in 15 to 20 years. Like I said, it's a huge sum of money. Just think, like $1 million. In a sense, this parable is about how we invest our money. As Christians, we believe that the world and everything in it belongs to God. We are merely stewards, merely caretakers of all the resources God has entrusted to us. Do we take care of the planet that God has given us to care for? Do we invest money we've been blessed with in ways that increase the dignity and well-being of our fellow human beings? Or do we use our money to our advantage alone? But this parable is Jesus' farewell to his disciples. I can't believe it's a simple investing lesson. The second meaning of the word talent is the one you're more familiar with, something that a person is particularly skilled at. Usually it implies natural skill, but it can also mean a skill that you develop over time. It can also be something you particularly enjoy doing. If you enjoy something, you naturally practice it because you want to spend your free time doing it. It is important to note, if we interpret talents to mean special skills and abilities, that we all have different talents. Just as one servant was given five, one was given two, and one was given one. But everyone has something, some talent that they can use to serve the master. I think this parable works if we interpret talent to mean money. We should invest our resources in ways that please God. I also think the parable works if we interpret talent to mean special skills or abilities. Each of us has a unique set of talents, and we should employ our talents faithfully. That means both practicing the talents God gave you so that you can hone your skills, and then using those talents to make the world a better place. The great thing about parables, this works no matter which way you choose to interpret the word talent. But what if this parable is really not about talents at all? What if it's about trust? It begins with an act of incredible trust on the part of the master. He gives his servants enormous sums of money and asks them to manage his affairs while he is gone. He gives them huge sums of money and doesn't even give them instructions of what they should do with it. I don't know about you, but even asking for someone to watch our house or water plants for a week is a little tough to do sometimes. But this master trusts his servants with millions of dollars. He trusts them to handle his affairs. This parable begins with an act of great trust on the part of the master. And the success and failure of the servants also depends upon trust. The first two servants trust in themselves, in their own investing skills, and they invest their talents and both double their money. But most importantly, they trust their master. Look at the reason the third servant gives for failing to invest his talents. I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. The third servant, despite the enormous trust and respect his master showed him, did not trust his master in return. He was afraid of his master. He didn't trust his master to be fair, and he didn't trust in his master's mercy. And so the third servant hid his talent in the ground out of fear. The parable doesn't say this, but I'm convinced that if the third servant had invested his talent and lost money, the master still would have accepted him with the words, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. This parable shows us a truth that we aren't always comfortable accepting. The worst that can happen is not failure. The worst that can happen is believing that God rejects us when we fail. That's the fear of the last servant, that if he fails, his master will reject him. And that fear paralyzes him and prevents him from serving his master. We know that God does not reject us when we fail. God loves us, welcomes us, and accepts us. God does not turn away from us when we stumble and fall. It is God who picks us back up. We can learn from failure. We can build on failure and become stronger. We learn nothing from fear, from sitting on our hands or hiding our talents. That doesn't help us grow. There is no learning, no growth, no improvement when we refuse to take risks. Kind of reminds me of teaching. We tell our kids, it's okay to be wrong, because then you learn. Take it from a person who has taken some risks in life. I had close to 15 interviews for a principal position for over 2 years before I landed my first principal job. Most people would have given up long before 2 years and 15 interviews. But I took a risk, and I failed, but I kept coming back. This parable teaches us four things. Success is a product of our work. We are to work using our talents to glorify God, serve the common good, and further God's kingdom. It also teaches us that God always gives us everything we need to do what he has called us to do. God expects us to generate the return by using our talents toward productive ends. The servants were given enough to produce more. It is the same with the gifts that God has given us. The third thing, we work for the master, not for our own selfish purposes. We should maximize the use of our talents not for our own selfish purposes, but to honor God. We should feel satisfaction and joy from doing our best with what God has given us, seeking to succeed in order to honor him. And lastly, we will be held accountable. The parable of the talents is not about salvation or works righteousness, but about how we use our work to fulfill our earthly callings. The unfaithful steward in this parable didn't so much waste the master's money, he wasted an opportunity. As a result, he was judged as wicked and lazy. We are responsible for what we do for God with what we have been given, and one day we will be held responsible. What we hear from the master on that day is up to us. Invest your love, invest your talents, and invest your love freely and confidently. Hold nothing back for fear, because we are children of God. We have nothing to fear. Amen.
Situation that's going on with
us pray. Dear Lord, we struggle to be patient and wait for your will in our daily lives. We don't always use the gifts you have given us to spread love to others. We want to trust in you, but the happenings in our world spread doubt and divide. Bring us together for your glory. Remind us that you alone can provide us with the peace that passes all understanding. Maybe it's simple. Daily we are called to come before you in prayer and praise. Daily we are challenged by your Holy Spirit to find ways to serve your people in your world. Daily we are called to share ourselves and our gifts with the people around us. Continue to guide us to those simple tasks. Why is it so hard, Lord, for us to use our talents for your glory? Help us to place you at the center of our lives, seeking to daily prepare ourselves for those moments when your kingdom manifests before us. Please keep in your prayers Wade's friend whose father was diagnosed with cancer, and keep that family in your prayers, and also for Kathy's friend whose mother was diagnosed with COVID, and she's in a nursing home. Give us strength, give us courage to continue to pray for healing, pray for those healthcare workers who are put in tough situations. Help to guide them to do what is right. Pray for health for everyone here, for those in our community, those named and unnamed. As we have brought before you the names of those people who are near and dear to us, we ask your healing love and blessing for them. Their needs are great and our abilities are limited. But we know that with your love, all things are possible. Give us such courage and perseverance that we may faithfully proclaim your love to all creation. Make us ready to receive you now, in this place, and everywhere we are. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Sustains you. Amen.